He is a consultant on creativity, innovation, and design thinking. So we would like to have Dr. Murli on the stage.
Good afternoon, everybody. How's the lunch? How's the gulab jamun? How many gulab jamuns did you consume? Honestly, how many ate only one? How many ate two? How many ate three? How many ate four? Very good. Life is short, man. Go for it. How was your user experience of the gulab jamun? Outstanding? The right texture, the right color, the right temperature. Perfect? Well, thanks. Say thanks to UXINDIA for that. We have design folks involved in developing gulab jamuns for you. Folks, welcome to the 2016 edition of the Academia Industry Panel. The question is, why do you have such panels? Here's the issue. Practically everyone has been through academia. Some of us managed to escape without going through academia. Those are the lucky ones. But most of us are compelled to go through academia before we let loose into the wild world, right? And then you have industry doing things, and it seems that the two do not often get along well with each other. Industry claims that, oh, you're not producing graduates that suit our needs. And then academia says, well, you don't help us define the needs properly. So that's why with this, the story goes on and on and on. Hopefully we'll never have, after a few years, we won't have this panel. So our job is to make this panel obsolete. But until then, we still have a job. Okay, so we have a panel of distinguished guests here who are going to be discussing this. And the way it's structured is we have about an hour, and 30 minutes you're going to present their views, you know, in bits and pieces. Then we'll switch over to audience questions. Please ask whatever questions you may have, raise contentious issues. And I'll remind you at that point to ask brief questions rather than give long speeches, which is often, you know, the opportunity to ask questions is usually used as an opportunity to give speeches. So we'll do that, okay? So come on, panel, come on board, one by one, and they'll introduce themselves.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's like an alphabetical order. I'm Abdul from Cognizant with 16 years. Started a career from engineering graduate, always jumped onto the UX, right? I represent the industry because I've been a student, got into the industry, now going for recruitment in different academias, so trying to bring out perspective from all the angle, right? First thing I'd like to say, right, the profiling of what is the market when it comes to design, right? Students should know what really interests me, right? It's not about choosing the career. It's about my interest plus is it really fitting me? Am I good enough? Do I have the right character, right? Do academia validates that and educates him on the right course so that when I observe him as the industry, we take him and make him productive from day one, right? A suggestion could be from, we always have a mentors club in the UXINDIA, right? So we could have more session before student picks the right course of their specialization, right? The second one is the integrated training that they get during the course, right? So we have multiple stage of the research phase, the design phase, the testing phase, and everything. Everything done in various semesters, and they get into pockets of various researchers, right? A small healthcare study in the hospital and an output, and a design in a retail store and an output, and a testing on a petrol bunk and an output, right? But if I ask him beyond design, right, the connectivity, from where did you start the business problem? What's your market research? What's your insights and how you translate it into design and what's the impact, right? Impact on experience or social impact or anything. Sometimes, you know, it's, so another request to academy is to make it end-to-end, right? Maybe end-to-end with respect to each of the unit, but how about a complete sample throughout? Of course, we can have more industry academia connect that we can help you to get that work. Another interesting thing that we see, right, during the point of the recruitment, a lot of ideas from the student comes up, right, as a great research done in a particular domain or a particular industry, it stops there, post they join industry, right? It gets into the industry way of delivering. So wondering, but it'd be a definitely a unique idea, a social idea that can impact to a greater extent. We don't have a platform to take that idea to a next level, right? We've been talking about supporting a traffic issue that we have in Hyderabad, right? How to be a part of Telangana's digital thing. We definitely have students, community, and college community contributing in various researches, but it stops in their profile before, it stops after they join the industry, right? But is there a forum, something like a social innovation forum with UX India that takes all the ideas, work across the industry, and take it to the next level, right? It could be led by the next set of researcher, or it could be participation from industry to take it till we achieve that experience, till we achieve that social impact, right? In 2013, there was a question, can India perceive for design, right? If you start impacting the experience socially with respect to all the people, definitely I'm sure the moment they feel the experience of the impact that design brings in, the community that we do, it's going to really bring our focus on that, yes, India is a good place for doing design and experiences, right? With that, I'll move on to the next
question.
Thank you, Abdul. Rishi. Hi, guys. I'm Rishikesh Joshi from Symbiosis Institute of Design. So here's the deal. I did my master's from IIT and have been working with the industry until 2014, after which I switched into academia. So I'm basically a person who's seen how the industry really works and then went to academia to see how I can kind of create a new generation of students who start thinking with product life cycle perspective of creating solutions. Rather, as my colleague here suggested, we don't really look at ideas, but the fun is if you can really identify the problems. That is where the sweet thing is. So this is what we generally do as an academia part of coming with is the biggest problem that you can find, or a problem which can have a really amazing impact within the social space, or you can say a commercial space. One of the foremost, I wouldn't say is issues, but there's some kind of offset that generally students feel once they graduate and then start with their courses is the structure that we will follow, right, from the design synthesis, ideation, conceptualization. It's not about Cogni, but generally Lean UX is a space that has been practiced. And obviously, since coming from the industry background, I do know that at points, there will be projects which are 1 month, 2 month kind of turnover time, and it's slightly difficult to do the whole of the research at that space. But what really needs to happen is probably more of people like me who have been in the industry but now want to contribute as academicians and, you know, help come and resolve this issue as to how do you deliver efficient UX while not you know, compromising on research part of it. So that's probably my small two sweet points.
Okay. Thank you, Rishi. Deepak?
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Deepak. I don't know who I am, because I studied physics and I liked it. And I studied painting. I was a practicing painter, I liked it. I did printmaking and I did a little bit of study on design education. I taught for the last 20 years. And I traveled, my biggest education I feel is I traveled all over India, almost by foot and by hitchhiking for 10 years. Okay, so, and I don't think there is something called UX. I think there is every design, if it's not UX, user experience, it is not design. So there is only design exists actually. And it is not a new thing because anything in the world, you look at it, if it is not good for a user experience, you don't call it a design and it's not a design. So now when we see in the context of this new world, it's a new job opportunity. So that's it. So that is where the industry academia clash, as he was telling, happens. Because industry comes for, okay, I want this baked bread. So, we don't have it because we actually cooked some kheer or gulab jamun. Oh, sorry. But actually, we believe that it's almost like marriage. Do you want an arranged marriage where you go and look for the right groom or right girl, everything ready, or you want to have a love marriage? I request my students to be in love marriage, in love with your design. You be a designer, you do what you love to do it, and let the industry, you lead the industry, you make, you innovate. So you have to have an innovation-led learning to build the and lead the industry, not follow the industry. Because the dream of innovating is only what actually will lead us further to make, now it's UX, maybe something else tomorrow. That's it.
Okay. By the way, Deepak didn't mention that he's on the faculty at NID.
Yeah. And right now I'm teaching at IIT
Hyderabad. IIT Hyderabad, right.
Okay, so I represent the industry, and I wanted to quickly respond to Deepak's predicament is that I'm available. I'm Prasad Bartakke. I am a co-founder and chief of design, Huge Designs, Pune and San Jose based companies. One thing I've noticed over years and years that there is this debate that happens to two meme, right? The academy and the industry. I think as we have seen all over the world, people are now sitting together and driving these debates into something which is actionable. If today we can come up with one or two actionable items on both the sides, I think then we will have a winner. Otherwise, next year again, we will be having similar debate. Luckily, Symbiosis Institute of Design is in Pune. Huge Designs is in Pune. I believe we have a lot of work to do, and I can promise I can create 10 star performers in Pune. If there's something that SID and Huge Designs can sign up, maybe first thing, have some meetings scheduled right this month, have some kind of agreement where how, if we can bet that, okay, 10 star designers will be delivered by Huge Designs, what is academy wanting to take step forward and say, okay, this is what we will compromise, because I think we need a big shake up in the way we learn and we perform in the industry.
Great, thank you. Satish?
Hi, I won't, you know, again introduce myself in great detail. So I'm Satish, I'm the global head of design for Nutanix. I basically stumbled into design. It's one of these serendipitous occurrences. I've been a lifelong, you know, engineer, and then got into management and stuff like that, and then, you know, started doing design just by accident and fell in love with it. So that's what I do for a living. So I mean, let me just again reframe the question that we are trying to address, or at least what I think is the question we are trying to address. It I think it's essentially we are asking what should be the relationship between industry and academia, and what is the goal of this relationship, right? I think that's the basic question we're asking. So in my mind, the goal is pretty clear, is to produce good designers. I mean, the world is full of bad design, from airplane seats to handles where you're meant to push a door and not pull it. I mean, everywhere you look around, it's just garbage in terms of design. So I think we have a social responsibility, and that is to produce good designers who actually make the world a better place for all of us to inhabit in, and also, you know, have good experiences. And like it, you know, like you say, you know, it takes a village to raise the child. Industry has a responsibility. Academia has a responsibility. Industry tends to be, you know, on the cutting edge of things many times. Academia tends to be on the cutting edge of things many times. And industry is trying to, you know, catch up. And that is, in a way, a good thing. So, you know, academia continues to lead in many ways. But industry tells us what is needed at that point in time. So it is a joint responsibility. And I think, you know, industry needs to play an active role in being involved with academia, providing the right opportunities for people, and also influencing what is, you know, being taught in schools. Those are my opinions, basically.
Okay. Thank you, Satish. Here's a question. I mean, it's both philosophical and practical, and you can address it in whichever ways. These are related. One is, are designers born or made? Related to that, are the right kind of people, students joining design schools? And are the right kind of people looking for design jobs? So all of these, designers born or made, what kind of people are selecting themselves or others selecting them into these disciplines and work? And you can answer in any sequence you wish.
Oh, okay. It's not my word. It's my teacher. There was a K.G. Subramaniam. The same question was asked to him about art. The question was quite arrogant. You know, he asked in a very nice way. Do you artists think that you are a different kind of people? So KG's answer was the most beautiful answer. He said, artist is not a different kind of people. Every person is a different kind of artist. So that's my answer to your question.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else wants to address that? Yeah, Prasad.
Yeah, so I think the whole creative thing, I think as you said, everyone is creative.
Yeah.
But I think designers are made. And in today's realm about what Satish mentioned and some of the other presentations mentioned, we have a lot more problems to solve. And that problem solving may not necessarily happen just by me sitting and meditating over a design and an idea would come in. I need to look outside, observe, think, come back, debate with other people, and then solve the problem. For that, there is a certain way the designer has to go through the churn, throw himself up to questions, get questioned, learn from it, and then become a much more mature designer. And so if someone is coming from the school, they are probably ready with some material, with all due respect to all what professors kind of teach. But there is a lot more that happens in the industry. Are the students kind of prepared for that? Maybe not. As you would have noticed in Rang De Basanti, right? That Amir Khan says that on this side of the gate of the academy, it's all fun. But when I go on to the other side of the gate, dunya puri nachati hai. And that is reality. And so can academics do something to prepare these guys for the other side of the gate, where the gates are open and they can still come and go out? And that's my proposal, that last year, which is the most foundational year when you're signing off from the academy, that 1 year can you guys spend in my office? I'm absolutely open to mentor them for that entire 1 year, but there has to be a strong program between, thank you, strong program between, or an understanding between academics and the industry. And I'm not saying just huge designs. There are, especially again, because SID is in Pune, I'm coming back to my office in Pune, but there are so many companies, right? In IIT as well. There are these programs that can be run in a little more different fashion rather than saying, okay, now go for internship, go there for 1 month, come back. No, I think we need to have a big shakeup. Did that answer your question?
That addressed the question very well. And we'll be getting more questions later from them. Thank you. Abdul?
Added to what he said, designers are born definitely, but they are made to the right shape by various folks, right? Including academy, the school, the staff, and everybody.
Yeah.
And what more importantly needed is, like you said, the changes in the curriculum, right? Mm-hmm. It's not the set of 2 months internship. I don't care which company you go. All I need is a internship output and data, right?
Yeah.
If I know you have the right qualities, creativity, innovative, thought leadership, am I sending you to the right internship, or does the student pick the right interns and get in himself excels in the right area?
Uh-huh.
That mentorship is what would be given so that they are made in the right way.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Rishi, and then we'll come to you, Satish. Thank you.
Okay, so then addressing Prasad and then coming back to Abdul. See, the biggest thing that probably I believe that we do is probably create designers which look at a design in the holistic perspective. I mean, let's say we are talking about a 24 student batch, when we are having discussions, we don't teach really, we discuss. We are looking at things which are impacting at different spaces. And what would happen at that point is these essential development years are for more towards the experimentation and evolution of a persisting knowledge bank. I would definitely love to have them focused on a specific core area, but would prefer to have some kind of a transition that happens. That once you have a bachelor's and you actually go into your professional space, there could be a transitional space, you know, and that is where they could kind of come down and try to find out affinities.
Great. Okay. Thank you, Rishi. Satish.
So, I have a simple view. I think inside every person lies a designer waiting for the right problem. Right? All of us problem solve in various ways. You know, a kid tries to figure out how to fly a kite. You know, you figure out, you know, how to, you know, carry luggage down a flight of stairs, and maybe you design something that is different. So I think that we have people, and inside every person is a designer waiting for the right problem to arrive, which is inspiring, and they're motivated to solve. So that's the view I have, you know, in general to the whether designers are born or made question, because I've seen a lot of people come from a variety of backgrounds or become amazing designers. Like on my team, I have a person who's an electrical engineer who wrote assembly code and went to school for electrical engineering and then turns out to be an amazing visual designer. There are people that come from, you know, with business backgrounds, et cetera, you know, who turn out to be amazing designers. So it's just that, you know, what floats your boat, what motivates you, what inspires you to actually think creatively. Mm-hmm. That's what in the end happens, and designers in that sense are made.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Satish. Here's a question. Does design education, as compared to, say, medicine or engineering or so many other things that have been around, feel somewhat, the design education as it prevails today, feels somewhat alien to many Indians as an education? Is there such a thing as an Indian design ethos that exists in a curriculum? Should it be there? Is design universal? Is there something specific to our culture that could be incorporated and inculcated, as well as is necessary to connect with Indian sensibilities? Is that a question worth addressing? And would that make any difference to this rift that appears to exist? Prasad?
Yeah, I think it's a very critical question. What has happened is, and I have it in my slides when I'm going to present a little later.
Yeah.
But so the computers came in 90s. Engineers in India, they started frenetically coding. And 2016, we see that, okay, mostly is designed, the whole thing is driven by technology, and designers have barely any say in it. Now we are then, because of the whole of that last 20 years, we have always looked at the West. And we are looking at them and then saying, okay, let's solve an app problem. Let's design an app here and an app there. So far, so good. Yes, we have some good case studies of, you know, the Olas, probably not Uber, but Ola. But there are so many other social problems that we still have in India that we could solve for this Indian subcontinent, or probably the eastern side of the world. I'm not saying we stop designing for the Western world, but there's enough problems to solve. For example, the DCP who had come in, and he's saying, oh, traffic is a problem. All designers have been talking about traffic problems for the last 10 years in the conferences. Have you done anything about it? No. So I think we should look at how architecture happened, right? Space design is pretty old design thinking that was there for the last 100 and 200 years in India, but that culture has lost. I think we have to look inwards and see each, as he said, each one is a designer, each one has the inner science of solving problems. Each individual here is unique, and if they can really think inside out, I think they will be far more designers, sensible to solve social problems, and so we can have a different culture created again in this world to solve problems, especially for this subcontinent.
Thank you.
Did that?
Yep. Absolutely, great. Thank you. Abdul?
In fact, when I met some of the students who take design as the course, right? Yep. When I asked them, what made you to choose design? They said, I don't like coding.
Uh-huh.
They gave me an option, is it coding, non-coding? I picked which one is non-coding, so I picked this. So that should not be the thing.
Okay. Great, thank you. Anybody else have a perspective?
Deepak? And morning, oh, sorry. Mr. Bapu was saying about the change that we expect, like how Prasad was mentioning. The parents start saying, hey, I want you to choose UX as the career, right? Mm-hmm. You would be able to achieve it only such changes we bring in, right? Okay. Socially impacting how a design. We keep talking about problems, right? Whether we call a call center or we go to a storeroom, in mm-hmm. a parking, mm-hmm. everywhere crib about the need. We know the need, we know how it can be handled better, but we see none of them ready to do it. But only we go an additional step in solving that issue, then we are qualified to be a designer. And the moment we bring such impact, I'm sure everybody would want to take this okay. as a profession.
Okay, thank you. Deepak?
The question was, is there something called Indian design?
Or design
for education? See, design education itself is relatively a very new discipline. You know, like it's a post-industrial thing that, you know, when machines started making objects, it needed aesthetics. So that double-looking things had to be made look good. That is where the formal name design itself started coining. Mm-hmm. You know? Otherwise, everybody was a designer. Leonardo was a designer, you know, or an artist, or a painter, or a sculptor. We don't know. We don't even call him. But today, I say, I'm a designer. But now, we even call it, I'm a UX designer. I do only this, you know. Mm. So that is where the specialization, super specialization, that is where this education also become like following the conventional method. Like if you're an engineering student, you go 1.5 hour, you attend to one lecture, then go to another class, sit another lecture, and end of the semester, you write an exam, and you pass, and, you know, that's it. You are an engineer. But design, at least, trying to look at things in a holistic manner, our courses run into weeks and months at one go, one teacher stays. It's almost like a Gurukul method. If you look at that way, Indian education system, I'm not saying Gurukul in the other sense, but otherwise the guild systems, they were living with the teachers, they're working together. That is where we made Ajanda, or that is how we made Taj Mahal. They all lived. They were, do you call the craftsmen or workers in the who made Taj Mahal a designer? Or you don't call them, I don't know. So, when you talk about education, what is education? You have to question that first. Is it compartmentalized in packets? Say, no, you are giving this, medicines, you have this and you have the problem solving. Because today I am facing as a teacher, the biggest problem is the pay package. Every student joining is, what is the package if I choose this discipline? Okay, that is precisely at IIT, we decided not to have a discipline. So everybody joins the same course and you do what you like. You join the course, we now call it visual design because I don't know the other side of the product design. So what happens is you do what you like and then you don't like it, you do the other one. You like animation, you do it. You don't like it, you do product design. If you like it, you do the next project in that. You do again like it, you do another project in the same discipline. So end of 2 years, you've done just animation. Or like people like me, even whether I like it or not, I will like to test another one. I do one animation, I do one product design, I do one UX, and I do something else. So I become a generalist. So breadth and depth, you decide. At the end of the day, the student actually decides what they want to do. Okay, instead of, we have like, I was in NID, we have 18 departments. You know? So once it's watertight, you join one department, you are a lifestyle designer, you come out. You have to give an entrance for that discipline. Here you, because I believe education should be open where you do what you like. You don't like it, you should be able to shift at any stage of life, which you do in industry. You know, like, you know, I have students, like I have one student who is 58-year-old, you know, and another student 38-year-old. They're all joined for MDes and all those things, like a master's level coming and working, doing something. I have a photography student, she is 62, you know, like that. So at any time, you want some formal education, you want to be away from this rat race, you come to academia, work, do what you want, sharpen the skills what is required for the time, like industry needs specific task. So you want to get into that, you come back to academy and then you get. So we have to be very, very alert. What is happening today in the industry, I should know. And what will be tomorrow is our vision. We should actually let them visualize that, because youngsters are the most intelligent ones, no? So it's like coconut tree. The youngest one is on the top. So the oldest one at the bottom. So we want, you know, this kind of an environment where industry and the academia come back and forth, you know. Okay. You need that thing to happen. Okay.
Yeah. Constant interaction. So, thanks, Deepak. What we'll do now is, did you have something very, very quick? Okay, if you can make a very quick, 30 seconds.
Real quick.
Yeah.
Okay. Won't talk about user experience design per se, because I believe it's a very evolutionary field.
Yeah.
We are only looking at things we can see right now. But this is one of the biggest challenges that I can see industry and academia looking at, is how do you really look at different design disciplines as potential talents to, take inside and utilize them so that you can elevate your product spaces to completely different dimensions.
Thank you.
It's a super possibility.
Okay. Prasad, and then Satish, you wanted to say something. Yeah.
Yeah. So Deepak mentioned about the salary thing, right?
Yeah.
Ki UX matlab jada salary, so I'll kind of have my kid, or the kid himself says, I'll do UX. If I'm doing HTML, I want to do UX because it pays more rather than the passion. One thing I just noticed about 2 weeks back, and no offense meant, but I received a placement form from IIT Hyderabad, and it clearly says, please state the salary bracket. Now, each designer or each individual brings in a complete different set of skills, passion from the other. It's going to be very difficult for the industry to say, okay, isko 6 lakh dena hai, isko 10 lakh dena hai. I can be writing on a piece of paper right now, if the person is really good, I'll be willing to pay them more than the bracket that has been put by, you know, the IIT Guwahati, or compels me to put a bracket. It does not happen. And that's the reason I want to probably cut that down, because let's respect the talent. Let's groom the talent rather than money driving careers. It will doom us in shorter time. That's my...
Thank you, Prasad. A very quick thing.
Sure.
Yeah.
I mean, I just want to answer the question that you're asking, sure, which is, is there a Indian design ethos?
Please, please go ahead.
Something you can look at an object and say, yeah, this is designed in India. Just like you can, you know, you look at a German car, for example, and you know it's a German car. Nobody has to tell you. You can, you know, you can take the logo off.
Right.
Or if you look at something that's Japanese, you know exactly what it is. In my sense, it hasn't emerged. That's an external observation. In design right now in India, I feel, is at an inflection point, and is very likely to explode over the next several years. The demand for designers is extremely high because technology, like I was saying in the morning, has become commoditized. The barrier to entry to becoming an entrepreneur, to build well-designed products that do just more than perform well, is very high. So, which all needs, you know, great design to happen. And I think that will bring about a certain design ethos in the years to come.
Okay.
And I don't think it exists
right
at this point in time.
Okay. Thank you, Satish. Now, we will throw this discussion open to the audience. Go ahead, ask your questions. Do you want to hold this?
Yes.
Keep your question brief. Make it one question, not multiple questions.
So we've been seeing these discussions since morning where the role of designers is changing. And from designers, they're playing more of a facilitator role, especially when, you know, we talk about innovation, we talk about design thinking, strategy, right? So my question is to the academia, are we doing anything to facilitate that change in the curriculum, you know, trying to get people to think of themselves as facilitators rather than designers?
Okay, so the question is, can we change, is there a change in mind? The lady suggests that the current mindset is that of, you know, the wise sage on the stage delivering knowledge, whereas the role of the designer is that of a facilitating. So the people design themselves, you're there as a change agent. Is there anything in academia that prepares people for that sort of a role, that you're a facilitator rather than a provider of services or skills and so on and so forth? She wanted the academics. If we can have the academics address that first, and the others can do that. And we'll keep it as brief as possible.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know whether I can answer as academia provides or not.
Yeah.
But in terms of design education, in all the institutes which I taught, I have taught almost, I don't know how many number, but so many institutes in the world. Most of the places, we actually train them to be the doer. Because the core philosophy of design is, design learning is learning by doing. Okay, but what happens is, it is there everywhere, no? Like where, once you grow in the ladder in the industry, you slowly become organizers. You know, you become, that is where you decide the point of quitting, you know, where people, like now, most of the designers work for some years. You can see him working in the industry, coming out and doing something else. I was working with NID for 14 years. I realized I'm going to become an manager. Then I started again coming. So I think we are actually training the designer to do hands on. But the as you age, you grow into the organizing. But now when you look at the industry now, where the technology has taken a lot of this handwork. So it's your intellectual activity, it is required. So mind activity is also design. So I don't think doing an organizing job is not design. That is also design. Because you are actually dealing with the design of in a larger framework.
Okay.
So you don't have to separate that.
Okay. Yeah. Rishi, thank you, Deepak. You don't have anything. You wanted to say something, Satish.
Yeah, quickly. So basically, I think, you know, the question is, you know, designer is actually a mix of multiple things and a facilitator. So what is academia doing? I mean, I'm seeing a change in the academia. For example, at the University of California and Berkeley, the design degree that you get actually has three components in it. You have an engineering component, which takes care of the domain expertise that you need. Then you actually take business classes, because you need to actually talk to the stakeholders in the business. And then you actually take design classes as well. And so, you know, there's sort of a new term that's emerging, at least in the field of computing, which is computational designers. And this kind of a mix is extremely needed for making good computational designers. So, and that trend is slowly being embraced by various other universities, and I see, you know, that being more and more prevalent as time goes by.
Thank you. Prasad, do you want to?
Yeah. So I think to answer that question, we could have designers become more of thinkers, facilitators, and drivers. So if you look at this popular video, right, Jonathan Ivey, he talks about it very emotionally about the unibody, the way unibody was created, chiseled out. So he's talking now about engineering and the overall philosophy. So he also drove design. So he thought about the design, but also drove the design and delivered the product into the market. And that's what we want designers to be. So probably what academics could do, I have noticed that all projects in academics are mostly deliverable based. So either create a wireframe, create a visual design, deliver this. Either some projects are 1 week or 3 months or whatever it is. Can there be certain assignments which are just think and share your thoughts, and you will be evaluated on that, rather than a deliverable always been expected. So, and being our culture of being a lot of doers, right? Our parents say, hey, do this, do this, do this. The professor says, do this. Instead of that, getting under the pressure of delivery, we barely think, and then scramble over the weekend to kind of send that deliverable out. So I think there would be certain assignments only for design thinking, where then they think about the problem, see how they can facilitate and drive a project without having to really show a sketch. Wireframes are passe. We don't need wireframe artists.
Okay, thanks a lot. Can we go to the next question? Thank you for raising that very, very important point. Any academics here, I hope you would seriously consider shifting the role of your education from being pure doers to doers and facilitators. Next question.
My name is Apoorv. I'm traveling from Miami with Marcelo here.
Yeah.
I'd just like to ask a question about, I guess we're talking about, you know, post-secondary, like education once students come out of the K-12 system.
Yeah.
So I've had the opportunity to go to school in India, England, Canada, like I've gone through a few schooling systems. And one thing that I found in India was there's a lot of creativity and problem-solving skills that are totally stumped when you're going through the system. So do you think that this problem of skill gap and, you know, people that are driven for careers through, you know, the salary caps and everyone wants to become a doctor, engineer, or a lawyer, it stems from the K-12 system? Like, do you feel that there's a big problem there and then there's a solution that can be implemented later on as well?
Okay. Thank you for asking the question. Can we deal with this problem at the school level? And I think that you'll find very strong opinions. And I would ask you, since I'm sure each of you can talk for this for at least half an hour each, to limit your comment to a minute, because all of us probably want to tear down the system, burn it down, crush it. But 1 minute, no more than 1 minute each, if you want to comment on it. Go ahead. Abdul, do you want to say something?
Yeah. Just to summarize this question, so yeah. Are we letting the designers to have the right problem-solving skills and thinking skills allowed as part of his career? Is my understanding right?
Or are you saying to transform, is the problem at the K-12 level, and can we do something about changing that, which will have downstream effects?
Yes, definitely, right? So the bachelor's course that we get into, right?
No, we're talking about school.
School, yes. The parents has to change, right? We should stop them completing the homeworks, right? And we should start addressing all the questions they ask. Anything that they ask us, why? If they say, I can't do this homework, you try to learn from them a lot, right? But it's other way around, right? We form a WhatsApp group. We complete their homeworks on behalf of them, right? We stop all their thinking, right? Just you bring them out of the school, kindergarten, the parents refer each other what the notes are, right? You don't ask the kid what happened in the school. You get the updates through the system, right? The system is making us go, you know, not allowing the thinking to happen, right?
I'll probably interrupt this because this is going to be a very emotional, packed question, okay? And we'll carry this offline. So I understand. Can we just move on to the next question? Because we know the problem does lie there. Okay, K-12. These folks are at the post-secondary level, so whatever they say probably cannot be carried forward. We're trying to deal with academia at the design at the postgraduate level, and in this, if you don't mind, that's the focus of this session.
That's a great question.
One second. See, we need an entire conference for that. Yeah. Not just design, all education. Not just one conference, 365 conferences a year. Okay, all right.
Sorry, right now I'm teaching in university, yeah. But I taught in school from class 1 to class 12.
Great.
And there I was teaching art.
Yeah.
I completely agree with you. Yeah. But this question, I wish there were some policymakers in the panel.
Yeah.
Because the education system need to be changed. There are small, small pockets which is happening. Actually, there are experimental schools happening. But they are becoming very elitist.
Yeah.
Okay. That is the only problem.
Thanks.
Very high.
Sorry if you don't mind if I interrupt. Let's go ahead to the next question. The reason we are interrupting this is nobody here can do anything about it at the moment. Okay. So, all right. Go ahead.
Hi.
All right. Next question.
Yeah. My name is Ajay. And I work as a UX designer.
Yeah.
So. All these elite kind of well-known institutes like NID and IITs do a great job, of course, and we all agree on that. But practically, you find a lot of people in India who are self-taught and who have come up on their own by doing trial and error. But sometimes they are really good, really talented, and they've learned a lot by working hands-on. So how can both industry and academia, like organized academia, support these people and make sure that we use their talent also?
I think it's age old, because when I was giving a class in IIM Ahmedabad, they said this is a typical HR problem, because where HR person is sent to recruit, like he want 10 people UX designers from the best UX designers. But there is a philosophy called a don't blame me in HR, where what they do is they go to, like I won't say design school, they go to IIM Ahmedabad and they recruit. If they are not good people, they will say, don't blame me, I went to the best school and recruited. And if you, even HR person take a decision and go to a different, not so well-known school and recruit somebody, and if they are not good, this HR person is fired. Who asked you to go to, there was IIM, you would not go there. This is what happens actually. So I don't believe that in NID and IIT are only the talents. Talent is there. I actually feel that there should be hundreds and hundreds of schools. Every engineering college should have a design section. Then it will be.
Yeah, Abdul?
Thanks. To add to that, right, so we started seeking talents, right, not just NID, IIT, right? One way is bringing the community knowledge known to everybody, right? We go to all types of colleges, engineering colleges, other types of colleges, talking about what the industry is all about, right? The design and how can they pick this as a career. The second one is we obviously get the deviation approval from HR, right? Away from the policy, right? If the person has the right quality, analytical thinking, good design thinking, problem-solving attitude, open, right? And show the passion, right? If I see a passion, I don't care about whether he has an arrear or a lesser than 60% of marks, pay package expectation is high. We can get anything done, right? As long as we get the right quality in the designer, right? So we are bound to any.
Thank you.
So Ajay, I think what you could do is look out for some guru in the industry and share your passion with them. I'm sure that is that will happen. I think it is a misconception that industry, when they're hiring for designers, they will only go for design schools. It's a big misnomer. There are people who have applied who come from engineering. He is an engineer, right? I've been full-time designer since I was a child, but he is not. But still he is on this platform. It still shows that he had some passion. He looked at the world out there and then changed his views. I think you should do that. And we could always do some offline discussion as well.
Yep, thank you. Did you want to
say just want to add a point. That's when I said designers are not born, they are made. In my plus two exam, if I see a two question, draw a neatly labeled sketch diagram of molecular, then I'll skip that question. And answer the other one, distinguish between membrane and non-membrane. I'll go and write all the 10 points because I can complete it faster, right? So I was born to be away from it. All my practical books are drawn by my colleague, right? Either it's plus two. I'm a biology student, but I ignore all the answers. But now I'm made, right?
Yeah.
Post-graduation, I joined Cognizant as a ELT, taken this design course, but now I know what design is all about, right? So that's a feel you will get it.
Right. At least 40% of this panel didn't think they were in design and they landed up in it. There you are. Yeah.
If I just want to continue.
Yeah.
I started from going mechanical through animation, ended up doing a lot of different things. I think it's all about how much rigor you have. See, the cognition and design doesn't necessarily happen extrinsic. It is intrinsic as well. It's all about how you can connect to design and how you can let it live and prosper, really.
Okay, great, thank you.
I think one quick thing, right? So I think there's enough awareness that, you know, designers can come from a variety of backgrounds. But I think the choices that managers face on a day-to-day basis when they're trying to hire is whether to make the safe choice, which is to, you know, go to a school like NID or in this case IIM, that, you know, for hiring somebody from management, that Deepak was saying, whether to make the safe choice or to take the risk. And I think we need to encourage people to take the risk, and I think design leaders in every organization have a responsibility, which is to encourage their, you know, middle line managers, first line managers to, you know, take a chance on the people where you feel the portfolio is good, but the education is potentially lacking. And if you, it's all right to fail. You know, you took a chance on a person, it's all right to fail. And, you know, next time you will learn from that and you'll know how to evaluate somebody better. And I think as design leaders in organizations, we have that responsibility to make sure that, you know, failure is not, you know, punished, and that people are encouraged to take chances.
Satish, I assume that your organization follows that principle.
Yeah, we try to.
Okay.
And the fact that, you know, there's a massive shortage of designers in the world is also forcing our hand, which is good.
Okay, great, thank you. Next question.
Pablo Picasso.
Uh-huh.
He had mentioned that each and every one of us is a born artist. But then as we grow, how we keep that artist within us is a challenge. So that is something you, today, if Satish is attending a corporate conference call and you give him a paper and a pen, for 1 hour's conference call and he's been scribbling something, at the end of that 1 hour, I bet he would have a good sketch, which even a designer would appreciate. So there is a designer in every one of us, but that doesn't need to be labeled with any kind of product management or any kind of, you know, corporate lingo.
Well, that's a great point. Thanks a lot.
Yeah,
thank you.
Over to the next question.
Yes. Yeah. Okay, go ahead, ma'am.
Yeah. Hi, myself Silky. And my question is more towards not the designers. It's more towards like everyone has to know about the user or the UX.
Yeah.
So what do you think the other streams like developers and testers also should know about the design? Because sometimes what happens is like when you create a product, in the end-to-end process, every stakeholder has to know about the user. So when designers tend to portray their points that this is important from the user's point of view, managers say, no, the deadlines are like, you know, we have time crunch situation, we cannot take this in. Developers say, no, the technical glitch is there, we cannot take it. The testers say, no, I don't know how to test it from the user's point of view. So it's not always about, I should not say bad design, I should rather rephrase it to not a right design. So it's not always a designer make a wrong point, but the other streams are not able to understand that user's point of view. That's why it's not taken.
That's a good point, but can you bring in the issue, what can academia do something about it? What is the relationship between academia and industry, and how does it relate to that? If you can just focus on that, because right. Since we can, so that we stick to the issue here.
Yeah, this is related to the earlier question on why a designer should be a facilitator, right?
Okay.
This is exactly that, right? If you are able to converse with the business on why you are going for such a design need, right? And you know the design that you have arrived at is to meet a particular business need and how it translates as a business outcome. And if you are able to convince the business, get the sign off, and your developers would follow what business is going to tell you, right? And you need to work with the developer community. You understand the technical feasibility. Don't design something that wouldn't work out, right? You be part of them as well. You know what's the best that you are recommending. What's the business output that you can get out of it? If it's a challenge about timeline, how you can help the business pass the decision to get it done, right? If you directly work with the developers, it will say, hey, get it done in a week, right? Then it becomes, you will go for a second best design or a third best design. But if you work from the strategy team, right from the business all the way to the delivery, then it's an easy bet. That's where you need to be a facilitator in terms of business, technology, design, and delivery, right?
Thank you.
You will feel the passion when it gets finally delivered all the way down to the product. And you should accept and motivate all the community of people who are part of the design. It's not my design, right? You know, we'll work together to achieve such a business results. You are and I going to look big over there.
Very
then
good.
The support will be very high.
Thank you, Abdul. Anyone who can speak to it in light of the relationship between academia and industry. As Abdul said, this is further proof of the need of training students as not just designers, but also facilitators.
Yeah, yes. So if I can go.
Yes, please, go ahead, Rishi.
One of the biggest things is probably a designer has to start talking, understanding the language of all these different stakeholders. You know, it's all about communication, and you being a designer, nobody's stopping you. You have a problem, you have to solve it,
mm-hmm.
right? The point of fact is how would you go about it and what's stopping you from going about it?
Mm-hmm.
Back-end Symbiosis, we actually go through a product pipeline and we'll also go around some tech spaces to give them how to communicate with the different pieces in a particular puzzle. But at the end of the day, it's who you are as a designer, which will lead you to how to communicate really with this.
Okay, thank you. Go ahead.
Just one comment, because this is basically a communication gap between all these segments. Mm-hmm. I think designers also need to be trained to understand the glitch and all those things. You know, what is possible within the limit, within designers were taught, in my company, this is deadline. Mm-hmm. My company, this is the technological level we are looking at.
Yeah.
All those things. Same way, you have an orientation to the technical team,
right,
that this is what designers are, you know, like, mm-hmm. but this is what they think and they do all those things. So I think maybe a nice restaurant in the organization where all these people can meet and informally chat and understand each other will be a, you know, better way to solve the problem. Otherwise, we all think that I am right, I studied, I know it, because I always hear this. I have studied it.
That's so it. Rather than sitting across the table, let's everybody sit around in a more informal context, okay?
A really good solution is a lot of designathons or hackathons where cross-disciplinary people keep on working together for like in 48, in 24 hours.
Okay, great. Hackathons, designathons. So,
I'll just say one thing. I think in academia, we need to probably have courses on influence, more right. courses on communication, and also some courses on emotional resilience. Because you create something and nobody is really interested in implementing it and delivering it. You know, you can't take it personally and people, of course, critique the heck out of it. So I think courses on emotional resilience are important. And I think, you know, the industry can, you know, inform academia that this is what a designer goes through every day in their lives. And this is the stuff that you need to arm them with before they come into the industry.
Fantastic suggestion. Folks, academia, please take note. Yes, we are way out of time, folks. Thank you very much, Satish, Prasad,
thank you.
Deepak, Rishi, Abdul. A round of applause. Thank you very much.